And the last known footage of her shows her walking toward a double freezer area.
Murders, mysteries, unexplained stories, and our family's crazy opinions on them all. Join us now. The Family School of Thought is in session.
We're live.
Okay, we're live, everybody.
Live from Michigan.
From all over. Hey, guys. Welcome again to this week's version of the Family School of Thought. Hope everybody's having a good week. Please remember to like us, to push that like button and share with everybody, and tell everybody where you heard us from. Okay, Jessie, where all can they find us?
YouTube, Spotify, anywhere you find podcasts, Google Podcasts, you can ask Alexa, just about everywhere.
Just get on that .com machine, that handheld one, where you
get on your phone, type in the Family School of Thought, and we will be there.
All right. Let's get going. Jess, I know you got a fact for us.
Yes.
From a history fact.
History Unexplained Mysteries. So this one is the Devil's Backbone. Have you guys ever heard of that before?
No,
I'd never heard about it either. So the Devil's Backbone is a stretch of roadway in the Texas Hill Country that includes several different farm roads that run parallel to U.S. Highway 281. The route provides travelers with scenic views, but centuries ago, Native Americans and settlers clashed violently in that area. I don't know if you're supposed to call them Native Americans anymore. Indigenous people. So, history, get on that one. Modern visitors have reported strange occurrences such as questionable vehicles, accidents, apparitions, and even disappearances along the stretch. Some locals claim that the roadway's dark and bloody history are to blame for the mysterious circumstances. One of the most reported occurrences involves seeing an apparition of a person riding on a horseback through the area. There have also been alleged sightings of an indigenous spirit, specifically the ghost of a man named Drago, by cattle ranchers. Some paranormal experts have even recorded electronic voice phenomena in the while researching the area. There you go.
Well, let's take that route.
I know. Sounds interesting.
Let's go visit a Jordan.
What?
Do you know?
It's a stretch of.
Where? It just says the Texas Hill Country. So
I've heard that term used from people from Dallas and from Austin have used that term of hill country, in the hill, like neighboring hill country.
Yeah, I don't know. It just says that it's the several different farm roads and they run parallel to Highway 281.
Okay. So cool.
281. We're going to have to look up 281.
Yep. We are definitely going to have to take that trip.
Yes.
Yep. So there you go. There's history, unexplained mysteries.
Awesome. Okay, Cass, you got a song for us this week?
I do. And again, it's another one of your favorites, Dad. It's not so much of a surprise, but this week's is going to be Rehab by Amy Winehouse.
Yeah.
I kind of know
what the song is about.
Right. This one is quite obvious. There's no, like, hidden meanings of anything like that. It's a very clear-cut story. But it is about singer Amy Winehouse talking about how she doesn't want to go to rehab. Everyone around her is telling her she's got, alcohol problems, drug problems. But she doesn't want to go. She doesn't have the time, She doesn't want to take that 90 days. And unfortunately, the like I feel like the celebration of the story or the song, and then, you know, Amy Winehouse's kind of very erratic behavior as an artist led to her death, I think. I think a lot of people basically praised her for this song. And then, of course, you know, she ended up dying just a few years later of alcohol poisoning. And I think if we really had a, you know, I think back in these, like the early 2000s when this came out, 2006, I think we as a society were very obsessed with the like misdeeds of Hollywood and, you know, kind of that drama of, oh, what are they going to do next? What are we going to catch them doing next? And so it really, I think it harmed a lot of Hollywood celebrities and singers and everyone that was in this business. And we didn't really take care of the artists as we should have. We let them sing songs about how they don't have time to go to rehab. And when they should have, I think if Amy could come back today, she would have taken those 90 days. I think.
Well, she did go to rehab. I mean, she really did go to rehab several times.
But it never stuck because they wanted her to be that way. They fed into that behavior, you know.
Well, they feed into all of them, the drug addicts.
Right.
Every movie star, everybody that lives in Hollywood, everybody that lives in California, New York, they all do drugs.
Well, it's more about the fact that they need them to be that way.
I mean, she was obviously a very insecure person. So when she cleaned herself up, she realized, you know, that. So
right.
It kind of
But I also think it is the, like, Hollywood producers and, you know, celebrities basically feeding into that. Like, you couldn't sell Amy Winehouse's records if she's not clean, you know. The whole point is that she's this wild, erratic singer. And if she got clean and stopped singing about it, you know, would she sell? So it's,
I think, honestly, I think if she would have got herself cleaned up, she would have sold because, you know,
I think so too, but it's that fear. It's the fear from producers that they're not going to be able to sell her as this certain thing anymore.
I mean, I think, you know, I love Amy Winehouse. I mean, she was just,
I know.
And
she was amazingly talented. I'm not questioning that.
A few years there, every time we talk about it, we're like, Amy, you got to make it to your 27. You have to make it to the 27. And when she died at 27, Cass, I'm pretty sure I called you and said, did we do that?
she definitely was
unbelievably talented. And if she would have cleaned herself up, she would have been, you know, like, you know, Lady Gaga does a lot of different genders and stuff. I think Amy probably would have done a lot more classic music style and really became a, you know, she was there for good. She wasn't just there as a pop, you know, get her moment.
Right, I agree. And she was really going into that. She was doing a lot of stuff with Frank Sinatra, which it is what kind of Lady Gaga went towards.
Not Frank Sinatra.
What's his name?
Tony Bennett. I remember Tony Bennett when he, right after she died, they interviewed him and she said, he's like, she was the real deal. I mean, she really had it. And he goes, but he knew when they were doing that, she was not going to make it because she knew. She knew herself wasn't going to pull herself out of this.
Right. But
I know her life history. I mean, she was at that point where, no, she didn't want to get rehab because of the fact that something in her history possessed her to do that. I mean, She didn't want to straighten out. So, I mean,
I think I heard her mother in an interview one time say she really had it in her mind. She probably knew she was going to die young. She knew she wanted to make that iconic image of herself. Because like Marilyn Monroe or James Dean, she had that in her, like she knew, you know, with the hair and the style and all of her stuff, like, you know, like she knew deep down, I'm not going to live long. I want to make myself an iconic character in time. And she did. Right.
Well, it's that, you know, old saying of the brightest stars burn the fastest, you know. When you have that huge influence, when you have that huge appeal, you know, you have to keep it, and it's hard to keep.
Well, she was the real deal. I mean, she really was. She wasn't just a pop star, and she had her own kind of sound. She didn't sound like nobody else. She was, I loved her. I love her.
Yeah.
You know, I loved all of her music. And it's a shame. It's a shame that we lost.
And that's that's basically why I picked this song. Is I actually, it came on the radio or something, or I listened to it. And it's one of those things where it's like, I remember when this song came out and it was big and it was crazy and everybody was talking about it. But now, like, looking back on it, it's just kind of so sad to think about, like, that this was literally almost a cry for help, to be honest.
I was just
the whole Back to Black album. The whole Back to Black album.
And you knew what the outcome was going to be.
Yeah, right, right. We knew it was going to happen. Like you said, like, that, like, us saying, you know, she's just got to make it to 27, like, we knew it wasn't going to be a forever thing.
Right. Also, I remember too that when she first came out, there was a lot of comedians imitating her and making fun of her.
You know, right.
But all of a sudden, that didn't last long because all of a sudden everybody knew this isn't a game. This is serious.
Right. And she was just always so skinny, and she always looked so unhealthy and like just on the verge of death.
I loved the beehive. I loved it, you know. Yeah, she had her own luck, but you know, I think the people knew that. I think that's where Britney Spears at right now. I think people look at her and go, "You can see what's going to happen." You know, it's like,
I think her career is way over. I mean,
it is over. I mean, she'll never be what she was, but I don't think she wants that neither. But
no, I agree with your dad that she's like at a point where she's. I feel like. With her conservatorship ending, I feel like a lot of people are happy, but we're also seeing that, like, she's still not mentally well, you know? No, like, the posts that she's doing now, like, are still concerning, and it's still, like, yeah.
Well,
like,
there's still theories out that she's still being controlled, or that she's still
right, yeah, the theories are that the person who's posting, like, it's really Britney.
Yeah, it's not really Britney.
But
she like went from or something.
Yeah,
they think it's like a doppelganger.
Right. There's a doppelganger.
Well, you know, they are saying that that wedding wasn't even real.
Right. Yeah.
Right.
That wasn't even her. And all the people that were supposedly at the wedding, you know, like stars, I can't remember who, nobody will comment if they were there or not. So that wedding probably was not even real.
Well, we wish this is a thing where we kind of are in this like drama loop of like, ooh, we want to know what happens next. But I mean, this is a real person's life at stake.
I think
you know,
really concerned about her. I don't think anybody's waiting, you know, watching and making fun of her. It's scary to watch her.
Yeah, it's scary to watch. But I mean, she was another one back in the early 2000s where it wasn't us concerned about her. It was us making jokes about her. It was
Courtney
laughing
Love.
At her.
Courtney Love and her, you know, it was, I don't want to say it was funny to watch her, but all the comedians were imitating, you know, making fun of her and everything. Well, this is a totally different thing. They can see she's definitely, something's going to happen, you know. Okay. And all the people who thought she didn't need conservatorships are, you know, going to say, oh, maybe she
I don't
did.
Think she, I think the conservatorship she was under was the problem, but I'm not saying that that's not. That her mental health
isn't she
still
doesn't need help.
I don't think it was correct. The problem. Maybe he wasn't handling it correctly, but
well,
she
wasn't.
Had a problem.
He was
That's
abusing.
He was,
I know, but he was abusing her, like her.
Yeah.
He was taking advantage of the fact that she was right. That she was mentally unstable.
The whole family and, was.
Right.
I don't know.
Right.
I don't think you really know any of us know the real story because I can see as a father, and I've got this daughter that's having this thing, and I'm like, okay. She's good at performing. Let's keep her busy doing that because all these other things
sick.
Are going to happen. You know, what's that?
Right. When she's sick or when you're making the money off of her doing it.
Yeah, that part's not right.
That's the problem I think a lot of people see is that whether it was good intentions or not, he took the money from that And spent, she, like, and used it himself.
Don't you remember she was supposed to do a second residency in Vegas and she just walked off the stage? Don't you remember that?
Because she didn't want to do it.
Because she didn't want, right. She never wanted to do it. So you're saying that you could see it because, oh, this is what she's good at. This is what she likes to do. She didn't want to do it anymore.
Right. Yeah, I know. She did not want to do it. Yes, you're right about that. I'm just saying, as not just her father, but somebody who's in charge of her life, it's like, well, we can't just let her flounder out there. We got to keep her focused on something. She's,
but that, you should have then gotten her the help she needed.
Right.
You can't just use her as a prop and say, oh, well, I'm doing it because this is what she loves.
No,
if you're really concerned about her health, you need to go get her into a rehab, get her into a mental facility where she is taken care of.
Get her proper money.
And don't spend all her money.
Don't set up all these concerts so that you can collect the money for them because you don't want to work.
Like, get her into the therapy that she needs and things that are going to help her.
Right.
I mean, I just wish all the people
out there
trying to free Brittany were trying to get her help elsewhere, not just,
yes, I agree.
Free, go do your thing.
Yeah.
You know.
I agree. I think she needs actual help. She needs therapy. She needs, you know, medication. There's nothing wrong with being, you know, put on medication for mental health. Also,
part of it is the medication that she was put on, lithium, with her
family. Right, what? The right medication, I should say. The right.
But that's, like, the effects of the medication, the wrong medications, obviously have some mental side effects to it, too.
Right.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Anyways, I'm sure Amy Winehouse had some mental issues, too.
Yes. And, I agree.
That's what drove her to drink, and she was doing not just drinking, but doing bad drugs. You know.
Yeah. Oh yeah. So but that's the song for the week. It's the song for week, and it's a sad one.
And I love it. I love Amy Winehouse's song. I love all of her music. Okay, let's get on with this. Jess, no, D, you're up this week.
Yeah.
Welcome to my world.
Oh, the mysterious world of Denise.
Yeah.
So what's your topic?
What's your topic, Jess?
What's your topic, Mom?
It's your week. I told you last night. That
you're up to me. We are rocking tonight.
Jess, I think you're going to have to step in for her.
Yes. So today I'm going to talk about the mysterious death of Kenneka Jenkins. I think that's how you say her first name. Kenneka, maybe? Kenneka?
Oh, I think I know it.
This is from 2017, so it's very current, or somewhat current, I guess. But I've been saying Kenneka in my head when I read it. So I think that's how you pronounce it. I'm not 100% sure, but that's what I'm going to go with. So Kenneka Jenkins was born in Chicago, May 27th, 1998. In 2017, at the age of 19, she became her mom's caregiver and was helping her mom as her mom underwent surgery for her breast cancer. And she had just been, like, offered a new position as a caregiver in, like, a old folks home, you know, one of those nursing home type things. So she was kind of 19, just starting her life a little bit. But in that same year, in September 2017, her death became a mystery, and it was national news. So I don't know if you guys remember her name, but it was big national news. On September 8th, 2017, Kenneka told her mom that she was going out with some friends. They were going to go bowling, go to a movie, and she borrowed her mom's car and left the house about 11 o'clock at night, which seems late, but 19-year-old, that's when the night starts, I would say. I had some nights that started at 11 o'clock too. So, but instead of having the innocent bowling movie night that she told her mom she was going to have, her and her friends, they went to a party on the 9th floor of the Crown Plaza Chicago O'Hare Hotel in Rosemont, Illinois, which, I mean, it's like outskirts of Chicago. Yeah. It's O'Hare, so I'm assuming it's attached to the O'Hare airport, but I don't know that 100% for sure. So they went to this party. There's security footage that shows the group of girls. There's four of them, Kenneka and her three friends. They entered the hotel around 1 o'clock. So there was 2 hours from when she left her house to when they arrived at the hotel using a side entrance. So they didn't use the main entrance. They came in through the side. And the throughout the night, or the morning rather, the girls all posted to social media, doing live Facebook videos, doing Snapchat videos and posts on both social media platforms, showing pictures of them dancing and partying together, along with like videos of dancing with males. There are some videos that kind of show that men were, or boys were, like aggressively flirting with them, but they all kind of like pushed him off and, you know, told them to like back off kind of thing. They were just doing it. They were having a good time. They wanted to be with the girls. And Kenneka like at some point texted her sister around like 1:30 in the morning, talking about how like she's having a good time at a party. Around 3 o'clock, the four girls decided that they were ready to leave. But when they got to the elevators on the 9th floor, Kenneka realized that she left all of her stuff in the room. I've heard a different kind of story that, you know, like it was her stuff, but I don't know if she realized it or if her friends realized that she didn't have her car keys or her cell phone or any of her personal belongings. So at that time, at that point, the three girls that she went with left her alone. It's not really known exactly what happened, but they left her. There's some that say that the girls all took the elevator down. They realized in the lobby that she didn't have her stuff, so the girls went back up to the 9th floor. Some say that they left her in the hallway by the elevator. But at some point, the other three girls left Kenneka by herself, and they all three went back to the room to get her belongings. And then when they came back like 10 to 20 minutes later, a short period, she was gone. She was no longer where they left her. And so they started searching in the hotel, going up and down the hallways, you know, yelling for her. But the party that was going on was loud. There had already been complaints filed with the police from a noise complaint from these parties. So they couldn't find her. Around like 4:30 in the morning, they decided to call Kenneka's mom, Teresa Martin, and let her know, like, hey, this is a situation. Now we can't find her. We don't know what to do. So Tanika's mom told the girls, come and pick me up. So they went, and because they had her car, so they went to her house, picked her up, went back to the hotel, and began searching for Kenneka with her mom. The mom later says, like in interviews later on, says that she never really believed the friends' story. It just didn't add up. Stuff didn't sound right. And she could tell that all three of the girls had been drinking or under the influence of something of some sort. So she kind of figured they didn't really know what happened, but they were trying to kind of not be in as much trouble as they were thinking that they would be. When she asked their friends how much Kenneka had been drinking, they all said that she had only had one drink. And the mom basically responded that Kenneka didn't handle her alcohol well, and that one drink would be too much for her. But there's also stories that went around that she was seen drinking multiple cognac drinks and kind of drinking heavily. But after a while, the mom went to the front desk, or, you know, to this hotel security and said, my daughter's missing. Can I view video to see what happened after she left this room, like where she went? Like, we know where she was at, you know, like around 3:30 in the morning. We know where she was. We need to, like, and they refused to show her the video footage. They said that it, you know, it's not right for them to show. It's a safety issue. Again, she's 19. Kenneka's 19 years old, so she's legally an adult. there's no reason to suspect anything. You know, when a mom comes in and wanting to know where her daughter is, I can get where hotel staff would say, no, we're not going to show you this so that your daughter, you know, because you're looking for your drunk daughter, basically, kind of thing. So they kind of just blew her off, though. And then mom called 911 around like 7:15 in the morning because they still hadn't found her. And she wanted to file a missing persons complaint. And she told the she was told by the dispatch person that the friends were probably lying. They were all drinking. They were at this party. That her daughter is probably just passed out somewhere in some random room. She's drunk and passed out, and wait a few hours to see if she contacts. Most likely she'll show up, you know, later in the day because she wakes up and you know, wonders where she's at, and then she goes home kind of thing. So they continue, the three friends and mom continue to search the hotel. They continue to try to get hotel staff and police involved. But it wasn't until later in the day, this was September 9th, later in the day that the police began to investigate. They decided, yep, we should investigate this. And around 1:15 in the afternoon, they took the missing person case seriously, and they went to the hotel, began searching, and the hotel allowed the police to view the camera footage. It's reported that the police really, they didn't find anything in that original viewing, but they were more focused on the entrance and exits of the hotel. And so they never found anything. They couldn't find anything with Kenneka in it. They searched the hotel and the surrounding area of the hotel, and they couldn't find her, couldn't find any evidence of her. And it wasn't until around like 10 p.m., when they still had nothing to go off of, that the police decided to, hey, like, let's review the video footage again. Let's look deeper and, like, really see if we can find something. So Kenneka was discovered. The police were able to find her. She was discovered, like, stumbling around the halls near the elevator where she was left at, like, 3:20 in the morning. And she appeared in the video extremely intoxicated and confused and continued to, like, fall over into the walls. The one thing that I saw that was reported in some places and not in others was that this was near, at, like, around 3:20, she was near the front desk of the hotel. So that was, I don't know if that's true or not, or, like, where she was really located compared to the front desk of the hotel. But you would think that a hotel at 3:00 in the morning, I mean, I've been to Chicago hotels at 3:00 in the morning. The lobby's pretty dead.
Right.
You know,
right.
So, like, you would think that if you see somebody coming through, like, stumbling through, and I have a video, I may be able to share it later, but the way she was walking, you would notice as a, you know, an employee, you would think that you would notice her walking like that. And when people started questioning where she was, be like, oh, yeah, I saw her. That she went this way. Right. You know, I get not stopping her, but, you know, like, at least to, like, point them in the next direction. But the video, then they were able to, like, track where she went following the, you know, video footages. And Kenneka got onto an elevator and took it to the lower level, where she got out, and then she walked around some more, walked up some stairs, then walked into another hallway. And she even walked into, like, a men's bathroom and then walked back out. Eventually, she ended up walking into a kitchen area that was under renovation and it wasn't in use at the time. And the last known footage of her shows her walking toward a double freezer area. It's like a cooler in the, like, two, it had two doors. It's like a cooler in the front and then a door that leads to a freezer in the back portion of it. The videos don't show her walking into that cooler freezer area. It just showed her walking into or towards that direction, but there's no videos that show that actual freezer area. But the freezer was on and working and cold, you know. So After that, there was nothing. They couldn't find her. She never reappeared. The video footage from that kitchen area, the videos click on with motion. So it was a motion sensor camera. So when she walked into that area, the camera started recording her, but then it never recorded anything else until later on. And she wasn't discovered, she wasn't discovered until September 10th. Early in the morning, but she was discovered inside the freezer of that, the double, like, so she went through the cooler into the freezer area, and she was discovered at 12:48 a.m. on September 10th. So basically 24 hours after she was reported missing from her mom the first time, you know, so like it was less than 24 hours since they really left the party, but like really, you know, like about 1 a.m., you know, like they left the party at 3 a.m. She went missing really about like 3:20, 1 a.m. the next morning she was found on the floor in her clothes in the freezer. And she was obviously frozen to death. She was wearing some like ripped up, you know, distressed jeans and then a crop top, jean jacket. And then they said that she was wearing like a white bra kind of thing. And she only had one shoe on. So it never really mentioned if the other shoe was missing or if it was in the freezer. So they just said that she only had one shoe on. I'm assuming that at some point her shoe fell off and she was just too intoxicated to know it. Right. What was going on. But apparently there was some information that the freezer was at 34 degrees Fahrenheit, but that was after the doors had been left open for like 2 hours. So I don't think they tested it when they found her. I think it was like 2 hours later, like, oh, how cold is this freezer?
And yeah, that's kind of warm for a freezer. Mm-hmm. Like that's cold, but it's warm for like if you were using it as an industrial freezer. Right. That's really
and
warm.
So because the kitchen area was closed down for renovations, this freezer cooler area was only being used for storage. So because of that, like the temperatures were even lower and got down to like -8. So in the freezer. So it could have been that, but I never really understood the 2 hours after the doors were left open. So I don't know if that was, they like found the doors. There were some other things that were reported that a hotel employee shut the doors and like latched it and stuff. So I couldn't really find any real definitive information on that. So I don't know if 2 hours after she walked in there, she left the doors open. Somebody walked by and were like, oh, why is that door open, and closed it and latched it. So I never like really knew, but that, you know, it was reported that it was 34 degrees when the doors had been open for 2 hours.
Yeah, but you would have thought that whoever shut the door.
Well, the thing is though too, you got to think like if she went missing or she walked in there and it was like around like 3:20, 3:45, like in between, you know, before 4 o'clock, she walked into that freezer. And so you would think that if somebody came by, like, so it's like before 4 o'clock, somebody would come by around like 6 and like, oh, there's a door open. Hey, is anybody in here? And then nobody responds. You're just like, oh, okay, shut the door and latch it. The door also did have like handles in the inside. So if that like the door shut by accident, that you were able to get yourself out. So she just was not capable of opening it from the inside, or she passed out in there, you know. That's not there, like nothing was really reported, and like nobody knows what exactly caused her to die in the freezer. What happened on that? So the police they did their investigation. No foul play was ever suspected by the police. And then they, you know, she had an autopsy done and it was discovered she died of hypothermia, which is, you know, kind of a given, I guess, on that. But there were questions on, was she assaulted at the party? You know, like, was she, you know, assaulted by somebody an employee or, you know, somebody that was off camera? But there was no signs of sexual assault. There was no like signs of assaulted of any kind. The only injury she had was like a cut on her right foot, which was the foot that was missing a shoe. And then there were obviously injuries from the where her skin was touching the like the freezer and stuff, you know, just the freezer burns and frostbite kind of injuries from that, from not having a lot of clothes on to begin with, as well too. But they did a toxicology report, and the toxicology report indicated that her blood alcohol level was a 0.112, which is way above the legal limit, which of 0.08. But they also showed that she was under the influence of a prescription drug that's used for epilepsy or migraines. It listed the drug. I don't know how to pronounce it, so I'm not going to try. But her mom confirmed that she was not prescribed that medication. She doesn't know how she got a hold of it. She doesn't have epilepsy or migraine issues, that kind of stuff. But I did see in one of the stories that I read that drug, I guess, can be used for weight loss or, I forgot. There was one other thing and I can't remember now, but that's not like, maybe she got it from a friend, you know, like, hey, this will help you lose weight or this will help you like not be stressed or whatever, you know? And, so she was on that, but the toxicologist indicated that because her alcohol level was so high and with the use of the drug, both of those combined caused her to go into hypothermia faster than she normally would, or like a sober person would have, because it thins out her blood, you know, all that biological stuff. So her death, once all that was done, was ruled as an accident. And the case was closed by the cops in October of 2017. But her mom and her friends and a lot of conspiracy theorists they think there was foul play involved. They don't think that it was an accident. And so there's a lot of theories out there on like what actually happened. And a lot of it too goes to like, you don't see her walk into the freezer and you can't see that like back corner area of the kitchen, in any of the videos. So they are saying that, you know, something happened off camera. One of the theories that's going around or that has gone around is that her three friends were the ones that like did it, or, you know, like they kind of planned it, I guess. It's a theory that she was assaulted at the party, and or killed at the party, and her friends didn't know what to do. So they took her and placed her in the freezer. But that one's been pretty good, like pretty well debunked, because you know, clearly shows her walking down the hallway by herself and walking towards the freezer area. And then there's also video footage of like a hotel staff member right before, it was like around 12:30 a.m., maybe a little bit before, walking back to that area, going to the cooler, and then kind of coming immediately back out and calling police. And then the police, you know, like immediately come in, and then it's like, it was like 4 hours later though, that they removed her body from the freezer, which I thought was kind of weird. Like, when you think to like get it out, I don't know, but no. Whatever. But so that, I don't find that theory to be useful at all. I think that's just kind of stupid. But I think it goes along the lines with the mom's comments of she's never really believed the friends' story on what really happened, you know, and why, like, to me, why would you leave your friend that was clearly intoxicated? Why would you leave that one intoxicated person by themselves and all three go back to the party or to the room where the party is to get that stuff? Why wouldn't two people stay with the intoxicated one, and like do two and two kind of thing? Or why wouldn't you all go back? You know, so it's like, I just don't understand kind of what happened there. That's what doesn't
make sense. Couldn't have been foul play because, like you said, she was by herself and what went into the cooler.
Yeah, but I don't think it's really foul play because they can't control what was going on in that situation. But I think it's just one of those things that like, the friends know more than what they're saying.
Yeah.
You know, or they're not telling the truth. But if she's 19 and they're all, I think they're worried and they're all drinking, they're all underage. So, and maybe possibly using drugs, they're just trying to get as in less trouble as what was possible. Right. The least amount of trouble.
Or they made up a story because
yeah.
Now they have to admit that they left her like that.
Yeah, right. Right.
So, what time of day did they leave her?
So they never really left the hotel. They went back to somehow her car keys or her mom's car keys and her cell phone were left in the room, which is why like they couldn't have called her to find out where you are, because they went back to the room to get her phone. Left her by, it was around, they left the party about 3 o'clock, and it was in the videos show her like stumbling around the hotel at like 3:20. So sometime between 3 and 3:20, the other three girls went back to the party to get those belongings and then came right back to her. So I don't know why it would have, I don't know why it would have taken so long, but they may have not known where she left them. So then it's, you know, a search to find all that stuff too. I don't know. But then there's another theory too, that the hotel was covering up the murder, that she was murdered by a hotel employee and they were covering it up. The theory is that somebody, an employee, lured her into that freezer and then locked her in. And so, but that one again has kind of been debunked because she walked into the kitchen area by herself. The video clearly shows her by herself. And there was nobody else in that area. But I can kind of see that, where like if you're an employee with that hotel, you may know where all the cameras are and where all the blind spots are too. So I can kind of see that one, because that's where, you know, they'd say, oh, she was killed off camera and then put into the freezer. Well, that one makes sense to me, because yeah, you can like say, hey, oh, come this way. The front of the hotel is this way. Come this way. And then she walks in and she's so out of it that she doesn't really understand, but you're off camera kind of leading, like hurting her basically. And you stay out of view because you know where the cameras are. I know I worked at places that had video cameras and we knew where the blind spots were, so we could, you know, slack off and do everything we didn't want to do. So I think that's some of it too, is just, you know, like I can see that one happening, but it goes along with that. They locked her in the freezer as well, and she had no way of getting out. But there, you know, again, there was proof that there was a handle on the inside. But I could see that too. If you're so inebriated that you can't walk straight, you may not know how to get out. So,
it's dark. I'm sure the lights weren't on in the freezer. So, and I've been in a freezer like that before. There's no light to see anything.
I have been locked into a freezer like that before. Yeah.
I've been in a freezer, and that was my biggest fear, was being locked in.
This was an outside freezer. It was a walk-in freezer, and it was outside. And so I was doing inventory, and so I knew when the door slammed, it had a light on it inside, though. But so the wind blew the door shut, and I didn't think nothing of it, so I just kept doing my inventory. But then when I went to leave, that handle that you pushed was gone. It was missing.
Oh, no.
So I was in there a long time. Finally, somebody came and got me out, because they come looking for me. But literally, my contacts were freezing.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Yeah, I can see that, though, too, where she got locked in and just didn't know. But I saw somewhere, too, where there was, like, mention of an employee went and, like, brought out a black trash bag and stuff, too. But that's clearly debunked, because there is video of the police going back there and then the coroner's coming and rolling her out on a cart. So like the body was still.
And unfortunately, her picture, like there's pictures of her in there, like once they found her. So that doesn't really make sense.
I don't understand what the motive of an employee would be. Right. Because obviously they have videos of her stumbling around.
A lot she of wasn't the theories.
Assaulted, so,
right, exactly. You know, yeah, and that's where a lot of the theories were, you know, like this, that the employee saw her at the party and, you know, basically raped her and killed her kind of thing, and then put her in the freezer, you know, that kind of situation. But again, the autopsy confirmed she was not assaulted in any kind of way. So I think a lot of the theories are debunked a little bit, but.
Yeah, and you would have think with like something like that, like her clothes would have been messed up, but she was still wearing like all of her clothes. Like, yeah, they weren't a lot of clothes to be in a freezer, but they weren't.
Well, that
like, it's not like her clothes were missing.
That was one thing too that the mom brought up, was that when she left the house, she had a shirt on. When she was found in the freezer, she only had her white bra on, but her jean jacket was on over top of the bra. And so scientists, I don't know, whatever kind of scientists have said, you know, like when you're in going into hypothermia, you kind of start like going crazy and you start taking off your clothes rather than putting them on. But if you watch the video of her and her friends coming into the side entrance of the hotel, she's clearly only, it's not like a bra. It's like a
bralette.
Bralette, crop top. She's clearly wearing that. Guess what, mom? She probably left in less scandalous clothes than what she decided to
wear. I was thinking that too, so, unfortunately. You
know, like, every teenage kid goes through that kind of thing where what mom and dad saw, what you leave the house in, is not what you actually wore.
So, right. I would
say this really sounds like she just walked, stumbled into a freezer.
Yeah.
Fell.
Oh, that's
a shame on her friends for letting her.
That's what, and I think that's
what,
but there
is. And the hotel. And the hotel, because they had asked the hotel multiple times, like, hey, can you help us find our friend? They should have taken the time to been like, we need to look at all the cameras and see where this girl went, especially if she went through the lobby. They saw a drunk girl going through the lobby. They should have been like, oh, we saw her go through the lobby. We'll check the cameras.
When did they first start looking for her?
When they came back. So it was around the time that she was seen on those videos and stuff. Oh. And that's one of the other theories, is that the hotel is trying to cover up it, and there's some tampering with the video footage, the security footage, because they're saying that there was somebody following her through there, and she was trying to find a way to get away, like trying to run away from this person, and ended up in this, you know, like in the freezer or whatever, and kind of goes back to
That makes sense.
And
if
then
was following her, she said, I'm gonna hide in this freezer until they go by, or you know, kind
yeah,
of thing.
Right. And then, but then, you know, that theory is that the hotel, it was like a hotel employee, and that's why the hotel didn't want to show the mom the video footage in the beginning, is because once they realized what was going on, then they started to edit that person that was following her out of those videos, so that when they showed them to the police, that person wasn't there. So that's a theory that, you know, could be debunked. But I also think editing a person out of a video, like frame by frame, takes a little bit of time. And I would think that it takes a little bit more time than like 24 hours. So I don't know. I'm not 100% sure on that one. But I think that could be something too, where, or one of the side effects of that prescription drug that she was on was like hallucinations. So maybe she thought she was like, she hallucinated, she was being followed or whatever, or trying to get away. But I've seen the video too, and it looks like she was like, oh, my friends left me. You know, like I'm assuming in my head, like she's at the elevator. She thinks, oh, my friends left me, goes in the elevator, pushes down and hits the, you know, number one or whatever, which the lobby's on level number two, not number one. And then she gets out and it's like, oh, wait, this doesn't look familiar. Where am I? And then she's trying to figure out how to get back.
Right, right.
So
I think said that she was climbing upstairs. So she went back up another flight of steps.
And that's what, you know, but in, you know, like a stairway in a hotel could be just up to like a little level. It's not up to like the main level kind of, you know. I don't know.
There's some staircases like in hotels that are just for like employees. So they only go to certain like levels.
Right. And that's what, so I mean, to me, I think this was just a tragic accident, but I also think it's the moral of the story is don't leave your drunk friends alone.
Right. Like, and many times they do.
Yeah. I mean, I think especially with females, young females, when they get left alone or they leave by themselves, that's when tragedy strikes, because they get kidnapped or raped or, you know, whatever.
Right.
And that, I think that's, you know, kind of what comes down to it. But nobody's been able to confirm on, you know, like the side effects of that prescription drug with alcohol.
Well, that's another lesson to learn. If you're taking
prescription drugs, don't drink.
When you start drinking, what the side effects are.
Well, don't take prescription drugs that you are not prescribed to.
Yes, exactly.
This is a, you know, big case of, you know, these things have side effects, and you can't just use them for, you know, fun. Yeah. They're not for fun.
Yeah. But this, there's a lot of theories out there, and those were like the main three, but a lot of it kind of revolves around the friends leaving her. And a lot of it, a lot of those theories too are because the friends' stories have been inconsistent. Again, I think a lot of it was they didn't want to get in trouble. They were worried about their friend and they were inebriated on alcohol and or drugs, you know, whatever. But there are
ones that know what happened and they're going to have to live with that for the rest of their life.
But there were text messages found from friends that said, you know, like, hey, we lost Kenneka. You know, and another one responded like, you need to find her. So I think that something too is that maybe they didn't all leave the party together. Maybe she left the party by herself. They realized that she was gone, found her keys and her phone at the party. And then they made up the story of, hey, we were getting ready to leave. We realized we left the keys and went back. You know, that makes more sense too, that, you know, like she left the party by herself, but because she was so drunk, didn't really realize what was going on kind of thing. And, you know, basically walked out on her own free will,
right?
Drunk or not, but, and then they realized it too late. So
I was also thinking that maybe there was like a tiff between the friend groups. Like they were probably really upset with how intoxicated she was. I've been in those friend groups where like you get so mad at someone for being so intoxicated that you have to like basically take care of them and you're just trying to have fun. And so it's like, you know, annoying. And so maybe they were like, you know what, fine, we're going to go get your keys. Just sit here. Just sit here. We're going to come back and get you.
Yeah. And that's, or they got into a fight where, you know, you're so drunk, you're ruining the night for the rest of us. She says, fine, I'll leave. And so that's something too, where like, as a, you know, as a friend, if that's something that happened to me, I wouldn't want to admit that to the friend's mom. That, you know, like I was kind of
purposely left them.
Right, exactly. So, I mean, I think it's something those friends will have to live with. They kind of know that, I think they're the only ones that will ever know the truth, but of what kind of led up to the events, not what happened.
right. I'm sure they didn't expect anything like this to happen.
No. But they started searching for her right away.
Right. I don't think they had anything to do with her death.
Or they said it, you know.
It was just an accident.
Right. There was like an hour between when they said that they left and when they called the mom. So maybe they didn't search for her, but, you know, they couldn't find, or maybe they only searched for her for a few minutes and couldn't find her. But, yeah, I mean, the thing, so Kenneka's family ended up filing a lawsuit against the hotel for $50 million. With three counts of negligence. They claim the negligence for not properly securing that freezer area when they knew that the kitchen was not in use. They said that that area should have been kind of blocked off so that the guests couldn't go in that area, especially knowing that that freezer was still in use, just not the kitchen area.
I agree with that.
And then they also claim negligence for not stopping the party when they knew that party was going on. And that one, I think, but it's a hotel room that was only suited for four guests. And there were at least 30 people in the room. They had already had noise complaints for that room, the party in that room. There were illegal drugs being used and alcohol.
And how could they get 30 people in one little room? Those hotel rooms are not big.
Who's talking? I know we've had parties in hotel rooms before. We've had more than 30 people. Possible.
And you know, I remember
getting a hotel room for one of my daughter's boyfriend to stay in.
Not mine.
Him.
No.
Not the entire high school. Just him.
It wasn't me.
Yeah.
Yes, it was you.
Cheerleading competition.
Yeah.
Well, not my responsibility.
Well, right.
Where was I? Because I don't remember this.
Yes. Oh, yes, you do. It was one room for one boy to stay in, not for the whole entire high school.
They got in a lot of trouble, and they ended up back in our head.
I think the parents got in more trouble than the kids did. Because I remember the parents doing some things that trip as well.
Yeah.
Well, I don't care about the parents, but
we ended up
four boys to a freezing cold cabin and said, there, a party down here. Remember that, Jess?
No, I don't.
Standing there looking around in space.
Nope, I don't remember that. I blocked out that part of my life.
Oh.
But so, we can all attest that 30 people will fit into a hotel room.
Yeah, 30 people could fit in there. But there's the negligence is more on they didn't stop a party when they knew there was underage drinking and illegal drugs being used in that hotel room.
And yeah.
Somebody's missing.
I think the hotel is completely at fault. Like, I think
this was
preventable. I think it was preventable. I don't think they had, I don't think they're hiding something, but this was a completely preventable death.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. And then, so the last count of negligence was for not allowing the mom to view the video footage when she asked for it, when she first got there, because the family really feels that if the mom was able to have viewed that footage, they would have found her quickly. And probably would have found her, you know, because the mom got there about like 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. So, and she entered into that freezer like right before 4 o'clock. So they believe that they would have been able to find her within a few hours of her going into that freezer. And she possibly could have survived.
Well, if it came out the way that friends were saying, then the hotel definitely is liable because they weren't doing anything to try to find her.
Right. That's what I think. It's like, I don't think that they specifically had to show the mom the videos per se. Right. Because she's 19. Like, this parent does not have legal right to these videos.
That's what I agree with.
But they
you,
should have checked the videos. They should have done their due diligence. And that's 100% their fault then.
And the thing, and that's where I think, like, yes, they don't have the right to do that. But when you have, so if it's all true,
multiple people.
And hey, we can't find our friend. We left this party together. We don't know where she's at. And then now you have mom coming saying, hey, we can't find my daughter. I'm assuming that they would have described her, what she was wearing kind of thing, that the hotel staff would have said, hey, maybe we should go and look through our videos and see what we can find. And,
the videos, even though they're taking videos, it's not like the people that are working can just go get them. You know,
no, I'm sure it's not.
But there's probably a surveillance room. I don't know. Like, a lot of hotels have surveillance room.
Yeah. They have surveillance room. Access to them.
Yeah. Right. I think that, especially 2017, like, it's not like they're going to be on VHSs. Like, they're going to be on a digital recording.
I'll tell you a story. Or a scenario, lots of times, because you think that, right? Oh, it's, you know, 2023. I have better video in this house than a lot of stores will have. Because lots of times, businesses don't want that.
I agree with you, Dad. I agree with you. But the fact is, they do have videos. So we know they have videos because the videos are what we have as proof that she went to this kitchen. They have the videos. Like, that's not the problem. And if they have the videos, they had them available at that time.
And the police were called. Hey, so the police should have...
Allow me to share my screen.
A lot sooner. Yeah.
Allow me to share my screen. Because I have... This was a news report... Can you see it? I'm not there. Yep. This is a news report from CBS Chicago. It's only like two minutes and 15 seconds long. I'll kind of jump forward a little bit. Let's see. I think around here. But this is, it shows the video footage that kind of captured her.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know. Is it playing for you guys?
No.
No.
Okay.
I see it down in the bottom, but. It's not playing.
Come on. I had it playing before. Maybe it's not going to work. There we go. Maybe it's just going to be slow. But I ask this every single time I share my screen. Can you guys see my cursor when I am screen?
Yeah.
This is her right there.
Oh, okay.
What's this over there? What's that big white thing laying on the floor?
It's like an apron. That's
probably an apron. Like it's like an apron basket, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So it's like It's kind of slow motion, but you can see how she's like stumbling. Yeah,
and it looks like she's got. And it looks like she's got a video of.
That's her right there. This is
that's
the video
her
of
like coming her in.
That looks like a security person that just walked through there.
That was one of her friends, but you see okay. that she's wearing like a bralette, and yeah. I mean she's darker skin, so like her stomach. At least that's what right. it looks like to me. It's not a great video, but she's stumbling through the hallways.
Yeah,
poor girl out there.
This
like
one right
alone.
Here, it's like she completely runs into that railing. I think that's where the stairway that she goes up.
Yeah, I don't yeah. think that the hotel is hiding anything. Like these videos are clearly oh. just her, but this is clearly negligence. Like they could have.
Yeah.
They could have viewed this and found her way quicker.
Well, right. I really think her friends have some responsibility.
Well, no, her friends do, but not like it's not like a. I don't think they did this maliciously.
Not able to take care of herself.
No, like I don't that. Think they did it maliciously.
And like
I don't
you
think...
said, how did she get back into that kitchen area?
Well, that's
know.
Another thing is that that's what the lawsuit was. Another thing on that lawsuit is that they should have closed it off. They should have not made it. It as available to customers just walking through. I think that's for sure. They should have closed off that kitchen.
Well, that's so.
Or locked those freezers. You can lock those from the outside. They should have locked it from the outside.
They ended up locking them after the fact, you know. But I was trying.
And maybe she thought that it was a door going outside.
Oh, I think 100% she thought it was a door.
Definitely is stumbling around trying to find her where to go.
Yeah, right. that was the video though.
Sorry. Well, that's just yeah. sad. That's just
yeah.
sad.
Very sad. I think it's a tragedy, but an accidental for sure.
That's not very good, like footage from that. So, if anybody is interested in seeing the video, the Chicago Tribune has like a kind of like a I don't want to call it a minute by minute, but it is. It's like a timeline rather of timeline of events, and then it shows those videos in the correct series, the time series. So it is a pretty good thing, but there's a lot of like words and it's a lot of audio as well. So I didn't, and that one's a lot longer. So that one was a quick news snippet that I thought would be good. So wow. kind of show the videos, but
that's a
sad story.
It is.
But
it's
I think
a
it,
sad
was,
story.
It was just a tragic accident of she was out of her mind, inebriated, and didn't know what she was doing and walked in there by accident. I don't know. I was trying to find the results of the lawsuit, so I don't know. And then I forgot about it.
And I think I would be checking into her friends. So, did they give her that medicine? How did she come upon that medicine?
Well, that's I'm sure
that she hanging with that has access to that medicine.
Well, but you know, if she's 19 years old, you know, and it's in Chicago, she probably could have just bought it off the streets. You don't.
Well,
know.
And she could have got it from anybody at that party. Her friends were right. like exactly. with everybody yeah. at that party. Yeah.
Didn't you say she worked in a health facility?
Oh yeah, she was just because she's 19, so she had just like gotten a job as like
She could have for her yeah. taken that for yeah. weight loss because there is that drug yeah. that's real popular right now. It's for
right
diabetes.
Now, yeah.
But so she could have probably gotten that, and then if she wasn't a drinker, then she wouldn't have realized the consequences of. So she's taken right. that.
Well, and she's 19. You know, she's 19. Even if she like thought like, oh, I shouldn't do this. Like, you know, in your 19 brain, you don't think. Right. Oh, I can't do it. Like right. she probably was like, yeah, it'll be fine.
No,
I'll
it's
be fine.
Gonna happen to me, right?
Right.
Yeah, it's not gonna happen to me. 19 years old.
Right.
Going yeah. to a party that she shouldn't right. have been at.
So, well, I think we've all been there before. I mean,
but yeah, like, and that's what I'm saying. Like, you're 19, you think you're invincible.
Yeah, we've all been in those situations. I've been in a drunk situation when I was not 21 and found myself talking to a cop and having a friendly conversation and then walked away saying, I don't know what just happened, but it happens.
Well, you also met someone from the real world, so obviously your drunk shenanigans have
been. Yes, I did, but I wasn't drunk when I did that.
Oh, well, you're at a bar, so you're drinking.
No, that was at my apartment complex.
Oh, really? The bar. Yeah, I thought it was at the Wayside for some reason.
I think he ended up going there. afterwards, but we had a pool party at my apartment complex, like the complex put it on, and he was like a guest to the party. I don't know why he was there, but he was there. I have a picture with him.
For some reason, I thought it was like he was just like he was randomly at, well, not randomly, but like, you know, the Wayside does.
And
you know,
he was guest from DJ. He was from Road Rules, not the Real World. I can't say those. Those are tongue twisters.
Road Rules.
It was Derek from Road Rules. So, yeah. He was nice. I met a lot of people at college.
Well, so. Take care of your friends when they're drunk.
Yes. Please. Yes. Don't think, you know, nothing will happen to your friends if you leave them for 5 minutes, because
it could. Try to have that conscious mind thought of, I should not go off by myself.
Right. And don't leave your friends to go off by themselves. Never let your friends be by themselves.
Or don't leave with anybody you don't know. Like, that's, I hate that when they, like, leave with people they don't know. It's like, oh, my God, the worst thing in the world could have happened to you.
But look, yeah, and I don't care how much you put up a fight.
Hollywood.
It's do not let them go.
You know, look at every kind of movie that, like, oh, we're off with partying with our friends and we meet this nice person, this nice guy, and I'm just going to go home with them and it's going to be great. And then they fall in love and get married and have kids.
No, that doesn't happen.
Nobody who you want to get married to will take you home drunk. I promise you.
Mm-hmm. Right. They have bad intentions. So never go home with a stranger.
Never leave without your friends. Never leave without your friends.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But I don't know what happened. I don't know what happened with her mom's lawsuit. I don't know, or like the family's lawsuit. I'm assuming really what it was. It was a death lawsuit claim against the hotel. So their insurance probably paid out a settlement.
Right.
You know, of some sort. You know, I don't think it probably went. I think if it would have went through a hearing or a trial, we would have heard more about it. So I'm assuming that there was some kind of settlement. That's usually how death claims are handled in those situations. So,
well, especially like negligence ones, they just got to basically settle.
Yeah. So I'm sure it didn't settle for $50 million. I'm sure it settled for, you know, $1 million. But you know, you never know. So.
Well, and that again, that's, and Jesse, you're in the insurance business.
Yeah.
That's why a lot of businesses don't want good video equipment because.
Right. Because they don't want the proof of it. Yeah.
Because
right.
Now it proves. it makes the lawsuit more.
Yeah.
Viable.
So but it's negligence on the employees.
It was
the employees not taking. In not taking more seriousness.
More
people are saying we've lost somebody, we're missing somebody.
Right.
You also have to think too that most, like with the police, the person has to be missing for like 24 hours before they really do a missing person.
It wasn't a kid. And we've all been in hotels in the middle of the night. There's usually some kid at the front counter.
Right.
And nobody else around, you know, so. There was nobody around.
Right, I'm sure the employees were young kids who were just.
The employees were probably up at the party having fun.
Right. I'm just saying, but that's the best time to be in an emergency. And,
right. Okay. But I think, you know, I think things happen, you know, and.
I really think the friends have the most to blame.
Yeah, I do too.
I don't think so. I think the hotel has the most to blame because. You know, I think everything that they point out in the lawsuit is very clearly negligence. Like, I think this could have had a different outcome if the hotel had taken it as a more serious problem.
These friends
did what they were supposed to, you know, obviously, like, you're not supposed to leave your friend, but like, when they figured out she was missing, they did the right thing. They went, they searched, they texted that they couldn't find her. They called her mom. Like, I think they did everything in the situation correctly. Yeah, I think the hotel did.
What time did she call the mom?
At 4. So, like, only an hour after they started searching. Yeah.
So, that's what I'm thinking is that, like, they probably, I mean, really, it sounds like an hour seems like a lot. But I agree. Like, if, you know, and it says they left the party around 3. So, it could have been 3:15. you know, it could have been, you know, like you don't know.
Okay, let me go through this again. So they all left at 3?
There's no footage of them. That's what claimed, is that they all left around 3, and that at some point, either at around the elevator or in the lobby, they realized that Kenneka left her personal belongings at the party, her keys. I'm, you know, like it could have been something like, hey, you're not able to drive. I'm going to drive. Where are your keys? I don't have them.
Oh, so they weren't staying at the hotel.
They were planning to leave. So they were getting ready to leave the hotel completely. And so I'm assuming because she was so drunk, one of the friends said, okay, where are your keys? You are not capable of driving. And then that's when they realized, oh, she doesn't have her keys. Where's your phone? I don't have my phone. Where's your, you know, whatever else she had with her. And so then, but that's where, like, for me, like, why would you leave one person by themselves?
Right. All 4 of them should have went up to the room.
Yeah. Or I think with just two and two, like, basically two people go up and one person stay with her.
Right. Yeah. So it's
but they were probably all, you have to, like, think about it, like, they were probably all intoxicated, you know, they probably weren't thinking straight.
Right. Kenneka's mom had, like I said in before, she had mentioned that she didn't fully believe their story. Again, not that it was malicious that they were lying, but she didn't quite believe it. But she could tell that they were all under the influence, which is kind of scary to think about because they drove from the hotel back to Kenneka's mom's house. And then I don't know.
Oh, I thought they called her.
Back or what?
I thought they called her. Like, I thought they were like, still at the hotel.
They did. They called her at the hotel, but because Kenneka had her car, she had borrowed her mom's car. So she didn't have a way to get to the, and it was 4 o'clock in the morning. So I'm sure she could have gotten an Uber or something, but that's not really safe at that hour either. So, so they went back, and I don't know how far away the house is from the hotel, you know, but yeah. So. But, you know, and I don't know Chicago laws, you know, but laws take a lot of factors into how claims run in the insurance world and, you know, especially the negligence claims and that sense. And that's where, like, to me being the insurance person, that should have been blocked off. But as a normal person, functioning person, a normal, you know, intelligent person would know not to go into that kitchen area, not to go into a freezer. That could be something that could be argued. And then also because there was a handle on the inside, that's another argument that's not really a negligence thing that it,
well,
she should have known, but
that's, you know, that's the thing with these negligence cases is that we don't think about making or fixing certain things until something bad like this happens, like, yeah, you know, right. The like hot coffee thing at McDonald's, like the reason right. that it says caution is hot is because they got somebody a negligence sued. Lawsuit from yeah. cooking their coffee too hot and yeah. somebody spilled it on themselves, you know, it's yeah, those I things think. Where like this is where these things come from,
but yeah, yes. That's the story of Kenneka Jenkins and her mysterious bad. death. It's not quite so mysterious, but
I know I agree that it's, you know, the fact that we don't know why she was in there for so long. I think,
right.
Like, yeah, it's, you know, she shouldn't have been in there for so long. I do, like,
that's what I mean.
No really, matter what.
She was in there for, like, almost 24 hours.
Right.
Before somebody noticed it. And that's something, too, like, wouldn't you, like, people are searching the hotel. Wouldn't you have thought to search this freezer in the kitchen area that's not really being used?
The sad thing is no, nobody would have thought about using
yeah,
that.
Probably just think.
Yeah, but if they would have looked at the footage right away, they would have seen that she was down there.
Yeah. I agree. It's
all about that, the footage.
Right. Show they have clear footage of where she went. They should have found her.
And really, but when they started looking at the footage at 10 o'clock at night, when they started re-looking at it, it was like 12:30 a.m. they found her. So it was like 2 hours after they really started looking at the 2.5 hours after they started looking at the footage for real. So they, if they would have done that earlier in the afternoon. Who knows? She may have died already. You know, that's something too. They can't determine when she actually died.
When she died, yeah. But if they would have looked at 4 o'clock in the morning when the mom was saying we need to look, find footage. Yeah.
I agree. I think if they had taken it seriously. Well, we don't know that either. Like they said, that you know, alcohol and drugs will basically speed up hypothermia.
Yeah,
you know, you're not supposed to drink when you're in freezing situations because it basically lowers your blood. It thins out your blood and you die faster. So, you know, it's not that she could have been alive, but she could have been found sooner. You know,
Right, exactly. Yep.
Save the mother 24 hours of trauma.
Yep. So that's my story.
Oh, good job. It's sad.
It's a sad story.
Yep.
It's not a murder. It's kind of a mystery.
Just a mystery.
It's like the worst case scenario for each of the situations.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep. So there you have it. That's it for this week.
Drink smart.
Yeah, be safe.
Drink responsibly.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
These chairs are squeaky tonight. I can't sit still.
Okay, guys. I think we should call it a night.
How's weather in Portland?
It's nighttime, so nothing.
Well, how was it today?
Cold and clear. Nothing too much.
It's cold here.
Drizzly and miserable here.
Yes, it was miserable. Yesterday it dried up. Sun tried to peek out a couple times.
A little warm.
It is warm,
but today was 40, so I'll take that for mid-January.
Looks nice
this whole week.
It's not exactly a good thing when it's mid-40s in January in Michigan.
Well, it's rainy. I went for a walk at lunch, so that was nice.
In the mist?
I wasn't missing, but
it looks kind of sunshiny at your house.
Yeah, super sunshiny at my house. It's all the lights. Yeah.
All right, guys. I guess we'll see you next week. Please help us out by pushing that like button and subscribe to our station and tell your friends where to find us.
And let us know what topics you want us to cover.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm always interested in anything that you need to look up.
Yes.
I see more and more of you are watching, so please comment.
Right. Okay, guys. Talk to you later. Bye.
See you next week.
Bye.
Alexa played the Family School of Thought.